The learning objective of this chapter is that the learner will realise that not all of the quality issues are covered by the current fuel standard. We have looked at the contents of the ISO 8217 standards table for both distillate and residual fuels in some detail. We have also considered the quality issues that affect marine fuels. It should now be obvious to you that not all of the quality issues are covered by these tables. What is missing? Why are some of the quality issues not covered? We will now look at some of these missing quality issues and see why they are not included in the tables. Fuel, as we have already defined, is an energy source. Marine fuels are a source of chemical energy, which we can convert to mechanical energy through the combustion process. The amount of energy that can be released during combustion depends on the chemical makeup of the fuel and the efficiency of the combustion process. You are now aware of the fact that fuel oil is a mixture of different hydrocarbon compounds. The actual content of hydrogen and carbon varies depending on the molecular structure of these compounds. You also now know that fuel contains other elements, such as sulfur and ash. The basic unit for heat energy is the joule. This is a very small amount of heat energy, and so when we talk about the heat released during combustion of a fuel, we normally use the megajoule, which is 1 million joules. You may recall from an earlier chapter that the distillate fuel table from the ISO 8217 standard contained a parameter called calculated cetane index. This was described as a key performance indicator of the ignition quality of the fuel, the time delay between the start of fuel injection and the fuel igniting. It was stated that this indicator was not suitable for residual fuels. You may have noticed that there was no ignition quality indicator in the table for the residual fuels. If ignition quality is a key performance parameter, then surely it should be there in a table which defines fuel quality. The reason it is not included in the residual table is that it is difficult to reliably measure ignition quality due to the mixture of compounds within the residual fuel. There have been a number of indicators devised to identify ignition quality of residual fuel. Two of these are the Calculated Carbon Aromaticity Index, or CCAI for short, and the Calculated Ignition Index, or CII. CCAI is the indicator most often used. The calculated carbon aromaticity index is obtained from an empirical formula which has been developed from experimental data. The formula relating the density and viscosity of the fuel is as shown, and usually gives values in the range 800 to 950, with values above 870 indicating problems with ignition. The index has no units. Unfortunately, the results have limited value, due to the fact that the viscosity and density relationship can be affected by the chemical makeup of the fuel. Due to the unreliability of the results, it has not been accepted for inclusion in the standard. Long ignition delays can lead to extremely high pressures in the cylinder of diesel engines in certain circumstances. This can happen due to the almost instant combustion of the increased amount of fuel which will accumulate in the cylinder during the delay period once ignition occurs. The pressure rise in the cylinder is caused by the heat being released during combustion. This, however, depends not only on the ignition quality, but also the combustion quality of the fuel. There is evidence to suggest that the ignition delay is more of a problem with medium and high-speed diesel engines due to the relatively shorter time available for combustion in the cycle. The combustion quality of a fuel may be considered as the rate at which heat is released during the combustion process. The two main factors affecting this are the chemical composition of the fuel and the condition of the fuel as it is injected into the cylinder. The fuel density and the microcarbon residue value of the fuel are considered by some to give an indication of potential combustion performance, but this is not always the case. Fuel with a high proportion of aromatic hydrocarbons or other high carbon content compounds would have a high density and microcarbon residue value, and could be expected to present combustion difficulties. There are currently no reliable indicators for combustion quality, and therefore it is not included in the standard. Poor combustion quality can lead to heavy fouling of the combustion chamber and the exhaust system, with increased emissions and fuel consumption. Combustion can also be affected by the amount and quality of combustion air available and the condition of the engine cylinder. There have been many instances of unexpected problems, either during storage of or when handling fuel oil. These problems are generally due to the fuel either not being stable or compatible. If you have not come across these two terms before, then consider them for our purpose as being stable when the components that make up the fuel remain as a homogeneous mixture during storage and handling, and compatible when the fuel remains stable when mixed with another fuel. As we have already discussed, residual fuels are complex mixtures. Different fuels may also be mixed together or blended to bring the parameter values, in particular density and viscosity, to within the limits of the ISO 8217 standard. Blending should be done in a controlled manner which results in a stable product. Where fuels are potentially unstable, then separation of the different components may occur over a period of time due to high storage or treatment temperatures. This may result in either the heavier component of the blend settling out at the bottom of storage or service tanks, or heavy fouling of purifiers, both resulting in operating problems. This problem can be more likely with high asphaltene content in the fuel. Two stable fuels from different sources may become unstable when mixed together in storage tanks. This is due to incompatibility between the fuels. Ideally, new bunkers should be loaded into a clean tank and not mixed with existing bunkers to avoid the risk of compatibility problems. It is now recognized as bad practice to mix fuels from different sources in storage, and this should be avoided whenever possible. Obviously, as you will be aware, it is difficult to have completely empty and clean fuel tanks ready each time you take bunkers. However, every effort should be made to have minimum residues in a tank before filling with new bunkers. The problem of incompatibility can be linked to the asphaltene content of the fuel. Where there are high levels of asphaltene in the fuel, then there is a greater risk of compatibility problems. You may recall from earlier discussion that some of the unsaturated hydrocarbon content of residual fuel may be asphaltene molecules. These are heavy, complex structures, which may account for between 4 and 12% of the content of the fuel. The actual quantity within the fuel depends on the crude source and the refining processes employed in production of the fuel. For fuels which are inherently unstable, high asphaltene content may lead to serious sludging problems in both storage and treatment facilities on board. High asphaltene content is also associated with poor combustion performance. Measuring the asphaltene content would give an indication of sludge potential, but will not indicate directly if the fuel is stable. It should be obvious that when dealing with fuels which are naturally flammable, there will be a possible risk of explosion if proper care is not taken. Although the fuel standard gives an indication of the flash point of the fuel, it does not indicate the range of flammability. This is important when considering the vapor space of a fuel tank or when the tank is empty. There is an upper flammable limit, UFL, and a lower flammable limit, LFL, and a minimum oxygen limit. The actual values do vary depending on the exact nature of the fuel, but are generally taken as 10% gas by volume for the upper limit, 1% gas by volume for the lower limit, and approximately 11% oxygen by volume for minimum oxygen. Bunker tanks are normally in an over-rich condition when in use. Care must be taken when ventilating empty fuel tanks before entry, as the atmosphere may pass through the flammable range during venting.